So I will concentrate on the project that it's actually talking about development and designing of long-acting proteins, glycoprotein hormones, from bench to clinics. And actually, this project was started at Washington University, St. Louis, Missouri. There, actually, we concentrate on the structure and function of glycoprotein hormones using site-directed mutagenesis and gene transfer. And from these studies, we developed such an idea and such a method, actually, to increase the half-life of proteins. And there I developed one of the proteins that it's in the market already. I will talk about it later. And when I came back to Israel, I set up a startup company. We have very nice system in Israel. It's called biotechnology incubators. And in this incubator, actually, I set up the company using the results that we developed in St. Louis. We call this company Modigene. It's from modifications of genes. And then actually this company was, the name was changed by the Americans. They don't like the name, and they change it to Prolor Biotech. It's protein longevity redefined. And last year, actually, this company was phagocytosed by OPCO Health Company from Miami in the United States. And this company now is leading, actually, by OPCO in the United States. But the developments and the R&D is still in Israel, is going in Israel. So proteins for clinical use actually historically was extracted. FSH, for example, FSH was extracted from the urine of postmenopausal women. Human growth hormone was extracted from the pituitaries. Insulin was extracted from animal tissues. But later on, the development of recombinant biotechnology. So we use the gene transfer in order to isolate the DNA or the gene and transfect it into cells in order to produce the protein. And the protein actually give us the effect. So this technology was developed in the 70s, 1973, by Stanley Norman Cohen and Herbert Boyers. They actually succeed in order to prepare transgenic bacterium by transfer of DNA into the cells. And the first therapeutical recombinant proteins were developed in the 1978, human growth hormone and human insulin, later on in 1979. So the problem of recombinant proteins, most of the therapeutic proteins are smaller in molecular weight. It's less than 30 kD. And actually, it's filtered quickly by the kidneys. And that's why we can found the FSH actually in the urine of postmenopausal women. And actually, it's cleaved by enzymatically in the liver. And they have to be injected actually frequently to optimize the therapy and cause adverse effects due to picked dose injections because they inject the proteins daily. So some companies take care of this issue by pegylation and hyperglycolization of proteins in order to increase actually the half-life of the protein of these proteins. But actually, if we look at the strategy, that pegylation, you need to use the protein itself, and you need to produce the protein and make the change after production of these proteins. So we used another strategy. I will explain to you another strategy for increasing the half-life of these proteins. And again, we start this project by studying the structure and function of glycoprotein hormones, which include the FSH, the LH, the HCG, and the TSH. These four hormones actually are from the same family because they are dimers, consist of alpha and beta genes, And they the alpha gene is common for the whole for this group of proteins. So these hormones are dimers, consist of alpha and beta. We have two genes for each chain. Actually, it's needed to be ligated together in order to get the biological activity. Actually, without assembly of these proteins, there is no biological activity. And these hormones act through membrane receptors, increase the cyclic AMP in the cells, and then we get the effect. So if we look at the subunits of these hormones, the alpha and the betas, they contain N-linked oligosaccharides in the N-terminal of the protein. And if we look at the HCG-beta, HCG actually secreted from the placenta during pregnancy. And it's different from the whole group of the of this family of proteins. It's contained in the C-terminal. It's contained CTP, this C-terminal peptide. It's about 28 amino acids and have four sites for all linked oligosaccharides. And it's not exist in the other hormones. And we ask the question in the lab, what is the role of this CTP? Why it exists actually, especially in HCG? So we compare the structure of HCG and LH, and if we look at endocrinology, actually these two hormones are bind to the same receptor, have the same biological activity. The receptors are in the corpus luteum, in the ovary, and they are very similar actually in the sequencing, in the amino acid sequence. About 85% of the amino acids are identical in the LH and HCG. But the main difference is this CTP exists in HCG and not exists in LH. So structure function studies and Christial studies show that this CTP actually is not involved in the folding of the protein. It's floating. It's not involved in the protein. And so this is the sequence of the CTP, this peptide. It's 28 amino acids with four sites for all linked oligosaccharides. And the first experiment done in the lab, actually we take off the CTP from HCG beta by side-directed mutagenesis. We mutated the gene in before the CTP with stop codon, and we produce actually HCG without this CTP. The results show that no effect on the assembly of the subunits. This beta is still assembled with the alpha. No effect on receptor binding, no effect on in vitro biological activity. However, when we measure the biological activity in vivo, we show that it significantly decreased the biological activity. From these results, we actually conclude that maybe this CTP is involved and it's important for the half-life and biological activity in vivo of the protein. And actually, if we look at evolutionary, the HCG we need it for the pregnancy for a long time. LH we need it only for one night for the ovulation. So this is the main difference. And then we took this idea in order to shuttle this CTP in other proteins and see if it's actually affect the biological activity in vivo and increase the half-life. So this is the strategy that I'm going to describe briefly. So we shuttle this CTP in any protein in order to prepare a chimeric gene with the CTP, and maybe it's increased the half-life of the protein in vivo. So the first protein that we work on, this is the FSH analog. So FSH, just to remind you, it's secreted from the pituitary and work on the gonads, in the ovary and the testes, and it's actually responsible for the development of follicles in the ovary, and this is the graafian follicle. Without FSH, actually, there is no graafian follicle, and FSH is used for in vitro fertilization all over the world. So the main work was we took the part of the gene from HCG beta and ligated to the gene of FSH beta, preparing the chimeric gene with FSH beta and CTP. And the first question that we ask many questions actually after this ligation. First of all, does this chimeric gene assembled with alpha So if we get the assembly of the protein, actually without assembly there is no biological activity. And the other question, if this chimeric gene still binds to the receptor with high affinity, and what about biological activity in vitro? What about biological activity in vivo? And the most important point is immunogenicity. Because actually, from the first point, we look for the use of this protein in human. So we have here chimeric gene that does not exist in nature. What about the immunogenicity if the body actually produces antibodies against this chimeric gene? And we have some answers. So we shuttle the genes into expression vectors that's prepared in the lab. You can see here the gene for alpha and the gene for beta transfected into CHO cells. And we prepare stable clones, produce the protein, and actually we test further the biological activity of the protein. The first experiment, we can see here that the proteins are secreted very nicely from the cell, and here we can see the assembly of alpha and beta together, because this is beta regarding to the molecular weight, and this is actually the beta with the CTP, and it's secreted very nicely to the medium. Regarding biological activity, this chimeric gene still binds to the receptor with very high affinity and have the same biological activity in vitro as well as the wild type, FSH. However, in vivo, we can see here increase in the biological activity of the protein, and here we can see dramatic increase in the production of estrogen in the animal treated with these chimeric genes. So this experiment is very give us some directions. Actually, you can see here that four shots of FSH equal to one shot of the chimeric gene. And we can talk about it later in human use and how we can actually apply these results for clinical studies. Looking at the half-life of the protein, the half-life of the protein is much higher than the FSH wild type. FSH wild type degraded rapidly from the body. So another question that we ask, actually, we have here the CTP with 28 amino acids, four sugars. What is responsible for increasing the half-life? Is the sugars or the sequence? Then we produce the FSH-CTP, this chimeric gene. We produce it in LDLD cells. This is mutated CHO cells with the enzymes that add the sugars to the protein. And then actually we produce a protein with the sequence, but without the sugars. And then we compare the biological activity. We can see here the biological activity without the sugars is the same like wild type. And from this point, we can conclude that actually the importance here for increasing the half-life of the protein is existence of the sugars and not the sequence. This protein actually taken over in that time by Organon in Holland. Organon, I think it's phagocytosed by Merck in Germany, and Germany take this protein further on, and they develop it, and all the clinical trials for this protein made by Organon and Merck in Germany. So it was found that this protein, this chimeric gene, is effective in follicular stimulation. It's safe for use, and the most important point, they didn't find any antibodies in the body. So it's not immunogenic. And this is actually can take us over to produce other proteins by the same using the same strategy. And in 2010, actually the European Commission has approved the FSH-CTP. It's called Elonva right now, and Elonva is produced by Merck in Germany, and it's actually used in Europe and in Australia, I think, and it's also in Israel. I found that the clinicians in Israel in such a in vitro fertilization departments using the Elonva, and the main difference that Elonva is used 1 week shot instead of daily use of the FSH wild type. And this is actually make the big difference of use this protein in clinics. So we hope that Elonva will be worldwide use for in vitro fertilization. And but in the United States, actually, it's hard to get the FDA. And the FDA in the United States asked for repeated the clinical trials phase 3. It was repeated. They use it in 3,700 women for in vitro fertilization. Hopefully, this year, it will be approved, actually, by the FDA. So in the company that we set it up in Israel, we ask the question if this CTP or this strategy actually can be good for other proteins. We use the erythropoietin, growth hormone, interferons, factor 7 and factor 9, and we use it for short peptides. And I can say that the growth hormone actually is already in clinical trials phase 3 in Europe and in Israel. So erythropoietin is produced by the kidney. It's a glycoprotein hormone, and it's involved in the growth and development of mature red blood cells. The market of this protein is huge in the world. All the kidney dysfunctions, they actually use the erythropoietin in this purpose. And crystal structure studies done in Weizmann Institute in Israel, we found that both sides, the C-terminal and the N-terminal of the erythropoietin, is not involved in the binding to the receptor. That's why we take over another strategy for preparing long-acting proteins. So we shuttle the CTP in the C-terminal and the N-terminal of the protein. So we have here three CTPs in order to ensure that the protein has a longer half-life. So this protein is expressed very well in CHO cells and secreted to the media. It has higher biological activity in vivo comparing to the wild type, and it has even longer half-life than the recombinant erythropoietin used already and the wild type. A human growth hormone, this is another strategy, because the human growth hormone actually used daily for longer time, for 6 months, treating children. And so we use this strategy for growth hormone. And growth hormone acts on the fat cells and on the bones. This is actually, this picture used the transgenic animals with overexpression of a human growth hormone. Again, structure of the protein with the receptor, we can find that the C-terminal and the N-terminal are not involved in the receptor binding, so we shuttle the CTP in the C-terminal and the N-terminal. We have a couple of chimeric genes here transfected into CHO cells. It's well expressed in CHO cells, and we found out this is the biological activity in vivo. It's increased, as well as the FSH and the erythropoietin, and it has longer half-life already. And the most important point, we found out that this gene is not immunogenic in human. We are already in clinical trials phase 2 and in children and in adults. And now the protein is in clinical trials, phase 3. Hopefully, in the end of this year, we will finalize phase 3 and we get it into the market next year. So in a few minutes, I will show another strategy for preparation of recombinant proteins. I will talk about FSA, TSH. It's actually from the same family of proteins. It's again, it's a dimeric with alpha and beta. It's secreted from the pituitary, act on the thyroid, and it's contained N-linked oligosaccharides in the N-terminal of alpha and N-terminal of beta. And we ask the question, what is the role of these sugars in the protein? Using psi-directed mutagenesis, we can actually delete these sugars or these chains from the protein by changing the asparagine to aspartic acid. And we found that these mutations actually affect assembly of alpha and beta. There is no secretion of the protein from the cells to the media. Then we take another strategy that we ligate the beta gene and the alpha gene, making single gene for beta and alpha. with or without the CTP as a linker between alpha and beta. Both proteins are secreted very well from the cells. It's expressed in CHO cells, bind to the TSH receptor with very high affinity and have biological activity. Then we use these chimeras for mutations. And we mutate these genes actually in order to delete the N-linked oligosaccharides from the proteins. These mutants were very well expressed in CHO cells, as we can see here. It's bind to the receptor in very high affinity. However, the biological activity is reduced significantly. So, pharmacologically, such a protein that binds to the receptor with very high affinity and has no biological activity, you are in the concept of developing such an antagonist for this receptor, for this protein. So in these results, we can see here that the chimeric gene is compete with TSH wild type and reduce the activity. So we have another, we ask another question. In Graves' disease, there are immunoglobulins produced in the body, TSI, and actually it's bind to the receptor and it's caused hyperthyroidism, as we can see here, the Graves' disease. So we ask another question, if this protein compete with TSI or not. So our experiments show that also these chimeric genes compete with TSI and reduce the bioactivity of these immunoglobulins in our systems. So we are in the way right now in order to design deglycosylated human TSH that can be used as antagonist for TSH and for TSI that bind to the receptor and block the biological activity of TSH and actually reduce hyperthyroidism in vivo. So I will get into the conclusions that ligation of the CTP cassette gene bearing four O-linked oligosaccharides to different proteins is an interesting strategy for increasing the in vivo half-life and in vivo bioactivity. And it may allow reducing the drug dose, number of injections. As I mentioned before, for growth hormone, actually, we injected daily for 6 months. And in using this protein, we injected 3 times a month, every 10 days. This is the difference. And the other conclusion is that deletion of the N-linked oligosaccharides from TSH resulted in partial antagonist of TSH and TSI at the level of the receptor binding. And this actually, this variance may offer a novel therapeutic strategy in the treatment of hyperthyroidism and Graves' disease. Finally, I would like to thank the people involved in this project. Actually, this project, as I said, it started in the lab of Professor Irving Boehm at Washington University, St. Louis. He's specialist in the structure function of glycoprotein hormones, and actually the gene of FSH was discovered in his lab. So we did install any information from any other laboratories and companies, as I mentioned yesterday. So everything done in the lab, from the gene until the development. And I would like to thank also the foundations that we got from Rockefeller, from the BSF, by national grants, the ISF, the Israel Science Foundation, the Ministry of Science and the Ministry of Industry and Trade, and private investors actually that take over this company in the United States. They invest millions and millions in this company, and this company has an exit last year with $480 million in the USA. And finally, by the Baha'i's Gardens in Haifa, I would like to thank you for your attention.